Hello, boys and girls. The night has come, and I think it's time for another soft Python intermezzo. I say intermezzo in a way because, you know, I have not made a video in like 4 months, which is mostly because I have been going back to doing more set theory and some fancy logics, a little bit linear logic, and I kind of dipped into relevant logic, and I want to talk about that. And I also stumbled across this a very nice set theory book. It has the generic title Sets, Functions and Measures by two not really known Russian guys, I think Russian. And this is coming from a much more, let's say, logically minded, strict direction than this classic introduction. The logic is first order logic, of course, as they do, but the set theory they present here, it is basically Gödel-Neumann set theory, but with a lot of footnotes and elaborations of the context and equiconsistency with other set theories, and their ideas on, you know, whenever some bigger category theories have needs for set theories, what this to do, and so on and so forth. And I really like it. And I will talk about this eventually and make an extensive review. But in the meantime, I stumbled across somewhere on GitHub a project of a few guys basically using Idris for studying and developing for Petrinets with also smart contracts in mind, so I have to jump on it, I guess. So they have Telegram and some papers online. I started reading them, and then they said, you know, stop reading, we will release something better, newer soon. So what I did is going back to basic Petrinet stuff, because I have not done this in forever. And today, on this lovely Saturday, I hacked together some small Python scripts and defined some classes. And I actually found out that implementing a runner for Petrinets is you basically use the whole standard library intricates if you want from Python. And so I thought this could make for another nice kind of reference introduction to Python, as well as getting people on the channel up to speed with Petrinets if they have no idea about them. This is kind of this introduction, maybe preparing for also future videos if I find an angle to the stuff they do. They do basically category theory, using this for the execution of Petrinets, if I want to summarize it. Okay, so that all said, 3 minutes in, let's get into it, right? So these guys call themselves Statebox, and they have this nice domain, statebox.org, and there's the Telegram, and they also have a GitHub. I think currently they're working on implementing a CATS library, a category theory library for Idris. I suppose they will use it for their Petrinet tool for the product, which is not released yet. There's only a 1-2 year old like rough outline. But also online they have their so-called language specification, which is basically an introduction to Petrinets, as well as all the tools they want to use, which they will update, and maybe I go also back to that. So that's my kind of advertisement, because I find it very interesting, actually. And from here on, we will just talk about basic Petrinets. You know, if you Google Petrinet, you find these diagrams, and in this video I will kind of explain what they are, how they work, but I will not talk too much. I will just go to the code, and you will see by the code how it works and what it does. All I have to do is basically explain the building blocks they have this graphical representation, and if you know what all the building blocks are, like 3 or 4 ingredients, then you basically get the gist of it and can implement it, what we are going to do. So just a little background, because I love history of math and physics. So we have this nice looking fella who, like, this is all long time ago, and Petri is a very old idea, and it actually comes in many colors and forms and extensions. It is a model of computation that in the basic definition is not Turing complete. So that means you cannot run any, you cannot simulate any program, but on the other hand, you can make more statements about properties of them. And so he came up with them, it's used in a lot of fields. You can read this yourself, I'm not going to get into more detail. I asked around and looked around for some introductory book. I found this one, it looks nice enough. This guy, Reisig, he wrote a couple of books on Petrinets actually. Started reading that. It looks like set in Word, if I'm not mistaken, but and kind of uses up a lot of space. So it's I'm not yet decided on this. Apart from the presentation, but it's like a basic introduction. So if you're interested in that, this is my recommendation, or ask around. I have no idea, but that's what I started reading. And I also want to point out that this kind of, as a model of computation, it relates to other like graphically representable, let's say, models of computation. I did this very lengthy video like 1.5 years ago, introducing history of computation, and then talking about finite state machines as well as Turing machines. I even compute like a program that like by hand what that tells me if a string has length of power of 2. So to get a better understanding in what sense these kind of games, these board games, let's say, are make for models of computation, you might want to check that out. This is my self-advertisement and just as a backup. Again, I don't want to make this a 2-hour video, so I just wrap up here and go into the coding. So we're going to code this small script. We'll browse through it here quickly. I have uploaded it on GitHub, as you can see. So this is called, the repository is called petri-net on my GitHub. And we're going to do this. The nice thing here is I have also like given this an extensive documentation. So this, we will not do any documentation here for time's sake, but this is just some of the things I will explain while we do the coding. Okay, so last but not least, let's take a quick look at the Wikipedia article, because they always have nice graphics and such. So as a quick summary before we go into the implementation, Petrinets, they have the nice feature that you can graphically represent them, and they have a few ingredients. Firstly, they have so-called places, they have transitions, and they have arcs. Here we see an example of a Petrinet. The places are these ellipses or circles, and these are basically, in the simplest definition, containers holding tokens, some arbitrary countable number of tokens, let's say. So here, this Petrinet has 2 places, and they are connected by these arcs. These are the arrows that always go either from a place to what is called a transition, and or from the transition to the place. And so this is like a graph with vertices and edges, but the transitions are also encoded as vertices. You know, if this is a vertex and this is a vertex and this is an edge between these vertices, the transitions are here explicated as vertices themselves. And the benefit of that is that you can model movements of tokens, as you see here. You know, when this lights up, then tokens are moved through this transition in a way where tokens not only go from one place to the other, but if we look at other examples here, you can also model a transition here where token come from two places and go to another place or several other places. So this is why we like explicitly have vertices which are also transitions. Like the transitions are not just the arrows, but they kind of come together. And so this leads then to a natural notion of how to model them using categories, but we're not going to touch on that. So what we see here is a very simple Petri net, two places, three transitions. Basically, the first transition comes out of nothing, and we say that this transition fires, like when it lights up red. And what happens then is the tokens from places that are ingoing are removed, and tokens on the other side are produced. So let's look at this transition. You know, when it lights up, then something happens, namely this one token moved over, then it lit up again, and then the second token goes over, right? So again, this transition check, and then another time check, and then you know, do you see what happens there? And so we're going to set up let's say almost a generic framework, more or less, in Python, and we're going to also explicitly code up this example here. So this is a Petri net with four places and two different transitions. You know, the places, place one, place two, place three, place four, transition one, transition two. In this example here, we were going to define this transition so that both the quantity of token that it takes from a place, as well as the quantity token that it puts to a place, is always one. So when this transition fires, then we will remove one token here and add one token here, as well as one token here. And for this transition, when this transition fires, we will take a token here and the token here, and produce a token here as well as here. And no, you might ask, what happens when the transition wants to fire but there is no token? Well, then it kind of fizzles. Then it is blocked and it cannot fire. So let's go back. Opa. So you can read up on the formal definition of Petri net. Basically, it's defined as the places, transitions, and then this arcs, which are relations, how many, like basically how many tokens move. And so you can also capture the definitions in these grids, in these matrices. For example, here it says, hey, for the transition one that we talked about, the W minus is the kind of the information what it removes. So it says transition one, when it triggers, it removes one token here, right? And also it produces, this is W plus, it produces one token here and here, so this is P1, P2, right? And on the other hand, this transition, when it triggers, then it removes one from P2 and P3, from here and here, and it produces one from P1 and P4, so here and here. And as you can imagine, you can extend this, you know, you can not, in this case, always just one token is moved, but you can also like play around and make Petri nets which move several tokens, and you can make more conditions on when it fires or when it fizzles. You can also deal with different kind of tokens. In this case, we will only deal with one kind of token, and only one token will be removed or added from a place, but you can always extend this. So you can show mathematically that this model that I just described, it's not Turing complete, but you can do a lot with it nonetheless. And then if you add some simple, very simple, like there's one inhibiting condition where you say under certain conditions, extra conditions, the transition cannot actually fire. Then once you add more like information, more definitions to the model, then suddenly it becomes Turing complete actually. Okay, so what's different, just to point this out, to the finite state model of computation, which is simpler, is in the finite state model, you basically have one token which moves across the board. You can express it like that. It's a simpler kind of state, and whatever happens depends on where this token is. And in the case of the Petri net, you can execute or fire these transitions, like depending on the sequence of executions that you define, and they can happen on various places off on the board, let's say, and also affect more memory, let's say, more of the state, or what is called the marking, the state that the Petri net is currently in. Okay. So in the plain definition of the Petri net, it actually doesn't require you to fire the transitions in any particular sequence. This is basically left open, and so you can actually study, hey, in which like what are there for rules you can impose on how to fire the whole net, and what are the states in which the net can come, and so on and so forth. The plain definition is that you say, you know, you let if a transition is possible to be fired, then you just let it fire as soon as it has enough token that this is actually possible. And so what is also different in to the let's say finite state machine is that this model offers a notion where you can implement and study concurrency, right? Because like imagine for example a huge Petri net. There's some bigger examples here. Okay, I need a bigger one actually. Okay, so imagine a huge Petri net, I wonder, like a really big one, where you have transitions which are very far apart in the sense that there are a bunch of places in between them. Well, in that case, you can imagine that you can like fire two transitions which are far apart from each other at the same time, and the outcome will be the same whether you do it in sequence or not, right? And in this sense, independent transitions or independent movements of token can happen concurrently. On the other hand, it can also happen that you have two options and two ways of firing transitions, and they kind of are in competition to each other. For example, imagine you have two transitions that have incoming arcs from one place, and there's only one token, and both transitions would consume a token. Then whichever transition comes first consumes the token, and the other one can't fire after it because the token is stolen, let's say. Okay, so that's the basic setup. And this is now what we are going to write down all the ingredients we just discussed, and then actually a way of running this thing, and also then generating random sequences of the transition, and then running the Petri net and seeing what happens with it. So let's hold in for a second here. So let's just give a basic example without code. So for example, in this case, we said that T2 is defined in a way that it wants to consume one token of the place P2. So T2 wants to consume a token of here and a token here. And T1 wants to consume just a token here, right? So in this case, T2, if it would try to fire, it would actually fizzle because it cannot consume the tokens it wants, right? On the other hand, T1 could actually fire, because then it would consume this token, this would be removed, and it would actually produce two tokens. So this kind of adds actually an overall token. After this has fired, T1, then suddenly T2 can actually fire, because it has token there. If T2 fires, then it produces a token here and a token here. So we're back at one token here, but here was one added. So this net, as it is defined, is actually one where on this spot, one token is added. You know, one is consumed, but two are added. And this is a sync in a way that whenever a token ends up here, it will never be transitioned away. It will never be consumed anymore. So what actually happens here is that if you fire randomly these transitions, then eventually in this place they will accumulate more and more tokens. So this is rough analysis, and this is what we're going to see in the coded up example. So our strategy for implementing this in Python, which is not type safe and of kind of the dependencies are, we just let the kind of object model of Python do most of the work here. So we're going to define the Petri net as a runner for these transitions. And the transitions we're going to define in terms of the actions of the arcs, like of the arrows, right? And we're going to define the arcs in terms of what they do to the places that they connect. So you see here by the definition of the thing that an arc always actually connects a place and a transition, and either from a place to a transition or from a transition to a place. There is no arc which connects two places or two transitions, right? So if you look at the formal definition here, actually, then we see that the arcs, they are the union of the things, the relations between places and transitions, as well as transitions and places. So this is the kind of formalization of what I just said. So we define Petri nets in terms of transitions in terms of what the arcs do, and the arcs, for the arcs we need the places. You know, each arc has one place from which it removes or adds, and so we're actually going to distinguish between two types of arcs, the ones that go out of a place and the ones that go in of a place. So the simplest thing we're going to define first is the place. So this is Python, how to initialize, and the amount of tokens we're going to denote this by holding. And okay, I'm doing the implementation later, but basically we're going to have places. Then we are going to have, as I say, arcs, and we're going to distinguish between in and out. So I will code up an arc base, basically the base class. This will be initialized by passing a place to it, and also the amount or when the arc is triggered, the amount of tokens that it either adds or removes from the place, depending on whether it's an ingoing and outgoing. And since in our example we're always removing or adding one, I will give this a default value as well. So then we're going to have another class, which is the outgoing, and this is derived from the base class, and we're going to give this a trigger function. So, and we have the ingoing type of arc, which also has a trigger function. And so for the outgoing, actually, we also need the notion when the trigger is not possible. We're going to implement the function, which we call non-blocking. which will tell us whether or not the outgoing arc, outgoing from the place, can actually be fired or not, like can actually be triggered or not. The transitions are fired, which the transitions are composed of many arcs, if you will. And I you know, this maybe not standard notation, but I call the triggering of an arc when it does what it does, like changing the amounts. Okay, and then we're going to make the transition class. Transition, and let's copy that. So, as I said, we're going to define transitions in terms of all the arcs it has. So we're going to pass the outgoing arcs, out arcs, let's say, and the ingoing arcs. Okay, and then we're going to define a way to fire the transition, right? Okay, then we have PetriNet, or this is really a PetriNet runner because there's not much more to define. To set up the, like, since the transition holds arcs and the arcs know about their places, the only information that the PetriNet needs is the transition is basically all defined. So we are going to pass a list or an iterable of transitions. And the only thing that we still want here is a way to run the PetriNet. And we run it in different ways depending on the firing sequence, right? The way in which the sequence in which we want to fire it. So I call this literally firing sequence. And then for debug purposes, I'm also going to pass the list of places, because we are going to run it and then also print out, hey, how many tokens are in these different places. So I'm also going to pass the places, and I will, I guess I will call them places here. So, good, that's basically the definitions, like apart from the implementation, of course. I also will write a parser, like using a, like the whole basic PetriNet implementation is actually independent of any library. This will be Python standard library, but I will use the parser library so I can run it from the command line and with different inputs. So I will write a small parser that takes for one the initializations, like the number of initial tokens in the net as an argument, as well as for a random sequence of three firings, then the number of, like how long I want to run the simulations basically. Okay, so from argparse is the library that we want to use, import the parser argument parser. And so it works like this. This is generally very useful in Python, so how to set up the parser. We're going to set up the parser, we're going to make it understand two things, and then return the parser. And so this is an argument. So the first parameter that we want to pass is firings. It's the number of firings that we're going to pass, basically the maximum number of firings that are going to happen in the simulation. Firings, and this is an integer. And similarly, we're going to pass the marking. This is the standard word for basically state or initialization of the PetriNet in our case. And this is going to be several integer values, and so we have to do this plus thingy. Okay, and then we're going to execute this, right? So there's this standard, if you want to use Python as a script and nevertheless enable import all the classes to other files. You're supposed to declare this as main, and now comes the code that we'll run for the simulation. So I'm also going to do this later. Okay, so now we're going to do the implementation of all this. Very simple, we are basically done. Yeah. So this has a holding, and the holding is whatever we pass in the initiation. The arg base, let's say, has a place, like it's one place, right? Okay, this is also super trivial. And it has an amount. This is the amount that it will either add or remove. So if it is an outgoing arc, like the source of the edge is a place, well, then when it triggers, it removes from the place, right? So since it knows its place, we can access the holding of the place and remove. What do we remove? Well, the amount that we defined in the constructor. So, right? So when we trigger the outgoing arc, it will look up, hey, what is the place I'm supposed to change the holding from? And then subtract the amount specified. Similarly, this is the same thing, but it adds. This is the wrong field. Sorry. So this is for the ingoing. And then there's the other function where we have to check if triggering of the arg is even possible, right? So what is to be done here? Well, we just need to compare if this subtraction is actually possible. So we'll return a Boolean value, and we will return true if the holding is at least as big as the amount to be removed, right? So this is a bigger equal, so this will be true, and then this is actually legal. Okay, easy enough. So in the initialization of the transitions, we're going to pass all the ingoing and all the outgoing arcs. So for example, in this transition, we're going to pass the set of arcs consisting of the ingoing. This is just this one and the outgoing. And for this one, we're going to pass as ingoing these ones and outgoing these ones, right? So we're going to pass these two sets, and the condition of whether the transition can fire depends on if all the arcs can trigger. So the ingoing, the outgoing arcs, like outgoing from the place, needs to be tested. All the arcs need to be tested for whether or not they are blocking. So we will actually hold them as set. We could also deal with lists and then, you know, be very explicit about not passing an arc twice, because if you pass an arc twice and don't, then, you know, trigger, then we do something wrong or whatever. If you do a set, then all the duplicates will be removed. When we fire the transaction, then we have to trigger all arcs. So I will also collect all arcs as a member. And what is this? Well, it is all the outgoing arcs and the union, the set union with the ingoing arcs. So in Python you do it like that, which is very neat notation. And finally, we're going to write the firing operation. So we have to check first if none of the outgoing arcs is blocking. So by outgoing, not to confuse you, is these are all the arcs which go out of a place. Basically the left hand side here. So for this transition, this would be an outgoing arc, And for this transition, these two would be outgoing from the place. So we check as follows. So not blocking, this is a bool, means all the outgoing arcs are not blocking. So all, and then arc non-blocking. This is the method we have defined above. This one, like, it's tested for this arc. For arc in, for all of those outgoing arcs, right? We're going to loop over the outgoing arcs and for each of them check if they're non-blocking, and we require that all of those are true. Then, like, in the end, we're going to return whether or not it was able to fire or not. And if it actually is able to fire, then we're going to fire. This is easy. For arc in all arcs, arc.trigger. Right. We will actually return here this value just for debugging and printing. But basically, this is firing. Firing means looping over all arcs in case it's non-blocking, and triggering them. Then, when we trigger all arcs, then all these arcs will do their action, remove or add whatever they are supposed to do. Okay, so the patronet basically, well, it's easy. It holds all the transitions for sure, and running is also basically trivial now. The firing sequence, so this will be a list of names of the names of the transitions. We're going to give them names later. So what we do is, for all names in the firing sequence, well, we are going to get the transition, you know, this with the name. Name and fire it. Right, so running it is going through all firing sequences, in turn firing all the transitions. And now we're also going to do a lot of printing here that we have to code up as well. So okay, first, so this is basically the implementation of the whole setup. Now we would have to implement the run, which we're going to do later, but just to complete this, I will add some print statements here so we can actually observe what happens. So we're going to report what firing sequence we're using. So using firing sequence, then line break. Well, we're going to write it like this, let's say. So what this is going to do, it will write all the names of the the names after another that should be fired of the transitions, and connect them with this kind of symbol. And then we are also going to report the start marking. Start line break format. So we were going to report the holdings. P holding for P in places. So here we're going to loop over all the places. Like, these are going to be all places, and print out what are the current holdings. The only reason that this is an argument is so that we can print it out, and it has, we cannot really, we could in principle derive all places from the transitions, right? Because the transitions know about the arcs and the arcs know about the places. But I want to always print the places in the same sequence, like in the same order, like 1, 2, 3, 4. And to guarantee that, I just pass it as an argument here. Okay, and then actually we're going to end with the same thing. Say final. And moreover, I want to give some intermediate information. So firing will fire, and this will return whether or not this actually happened, right? If it was not blocking, then it fired. So if it was, if it actually fired, then print out the firing and the name of the thing, format name, and also print out this information. Let's do it like this. Check. Going to use the same sort of error. This is just, you know, notation. And this should be good. And else we're also going to report that nothing happened. Let's say fizzled. Sad face. Disappointed face. Okay. So, you know, you see the run, this is just debug information and then this simple loop. And so with all that, let's actually do the simulation. So first, we're going to get the args here from the terminal and parse them. So this is just this library, this parsing library. And then we're going to define the places. So I'm going to call this piece. The places are, so in the args we get the markings, right? Because we're going to pass them as we defined here. This will be a sequence of integers denoting how many initial tokens are in each place. So in our case, since we're going to model this thing, we're going to have four places, so we need four integers. And after the parsing, these will be found under args marking. And for each of these marking, we're going to create a place with this value m for m in. So it will loop over these four integers and create a place which we have defined here, which is basically a container for the holding. And then we're going to do the transitions actually. So this is going to be a dictionary, so we get these names, right? So that these transitions can be actually accessed as a dictionary. This is what we did here. And we're going to call them T1 and T2. So this is just the names I have from here, T1, T2. Could also use uppercase letters, I guess. And this is going to be a transition, and this as well. And so what do the transitions actually take as an argument? Well, the ingoing and the outgoing args. And so these take two lists, you know, anything that can be converted to a set, basically. And the first list is all the args of type outgoing. So this will look like this. Now we define the outgoing args here, they're called out creatively. Out. And the args take as argument places and amounts. And I don't have to add the amounts because the default value is one, so I just need to add the place. So this will be take a place here. And the transition one, for example, actually has only one outgoing arg here. So the list is here already done. And the place associated with this arg is P1. So this is the first place. So take all places. And so this is the zeroth, basically the first of this list. So this out is going to be this arg. And we're going to add it as only out type arg for T1. And similarly, we're going to add these two args, which go to the second and this the third place. So similarly to this, we have in 1, 2. Right? And it's similar here, but here we actually have two ingoing. This is the same as the outgoings here. So ingoing is one as well as two, and outgoing is also two. Also, sorry, outgoing and ingoing user. Should have called them a little bit different, I guess, but that's probably not a good way of denoting them. So the out of the transition to, I'm tended to say transactions because of smart contract, but transition, are the in with the fourth P and the in with the zeroth P, or the first P, so off by one. So the last one as well as the first one. So I hope this makes sense. Now we have the transactions. Now, basically, we can set up the Petrinet. We still need the firing sequence, but let's skip this for a second. The Petrinet is going to be the Petrinet with these transitions, right? The Petrinet takes the transitions as arguments. And now we're going to run it with a firing sequence, which is still to be defined, and the piece for debugging. And for the firing sequence, we can do something deterministic. So for example, we can say, well, T1 and T2, what is the example? I had an example on the GitHub, so let's stick with that. So this would be a valid firing sequence, right? A sequence of four or any number. And it can be any number of transitions in sequence, and then with run they will be passed to this and be executed in sequence. We can do this. I will keep it stochastic here and just generate random transitions of a length of my choice. And how do we do that? Well, here's the second library we're going to import. The choice function, which takes a random element of list, and so the firing sequence is going to be a list, and it's going to be a choice from the list of keys of the transitions. So t.keys, these are these two names, t1, t2. We need to cast it to a list to use the choice function, and so this, every time this thing is called, every time this thing is called, we get a random element, and we're going to do this a bunch of times. You know, we're choosing random elements for. We don't need this index. In and now, the number of times we're going to fire is, at most, this value that we are going to parse. So args firing. So we're going to pass this to the command line. Let's say we pass 10, then we're going to fire 10 times at most. No, it's at most because it might be blocked. And we're going to choose random transitions from that. And well, that's it, that should be it. I'm pretty sure I have some error somewhere, but let's see. So, okay. I have my Python scripts in this folder. This is what we're going to call. The way we're going to call it is described also on the GitHub. So we're going to do Python. This, by the way, compatible with Python 2 and 3. I'm not sure of that. I called it Petrinet, doesn't matter. And we're going to use parameters. We say firings, let's say, I think good numbers, let's say 6 times, and then marking, and what is the sequence I chose? So this is just the how many tokens, right? And just to highlight some effects that happens, I'm going to use this 1, 2, 3, 2. So what this means is we're going to put 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, and 2 here, and fire a random one of those 10 times. So and like it can choose which one it wants to fire, and we're going to fire at most 10 times. So okay, let's see what happens. Okay. object has no parameters. Let's see. Now we're going to, of course, have to debug because like blind coding is always goes wrong. So what is his issue here? Let's see. Place, so it takes an argument. Self holding. No, it looks good. Looks good to me. Okay, I have to find this out quickly because I'm far too lazy to cut it out of the video. So I will make the music a little louder for chilling while I try to debug this. I don't see it yet now, but you know, I'm just going to cheat here and skip over to the other script. I think I did the exact same thing, but let me see. Ah well, so be it. Probably have some other one of the class definitions wrong, although it looks perfectly nice. If I find it out, I will add it to the description box. But let's just stick with this code that I prepared before. So we're actually going to run the other one, which I tested. Petri net. And this is. Probably. Okay. Yeah, so good. This works. Okay, let me do this again. This works because I prepared it to work. So. We hit enter and we get a firing sequence of 6 transitions. He chooses them at random. So in this case, it's T2, 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 T1, T1, T2. We pass the starting values 1, 2, 3, 4, 2. We print it out for debugging purposes again. And so he tries to fire T2. It works. What T2 does, let's go back to that. T2 eats these 2 and adds them. So actually, T2 is a transition that affects all places. So it removes here 2 and here 2. So what must happen is one must be removed here and here. This is the second and third place. And one is added here and here. So we see this is actually what happens. So here one is removed and here one is added. And this can happen again. So the second randomly chosen transition is again this. Another one token is removed in place number 2, in place number 3 as well. And now in the fourth one, we already have 4. And in the first one, we have 2. Okay, and now the third one actually happens to be again T2. Like this is by accident, 3 times T2 in a row. But now this place here has no tokens anymore, as in the picture actually. So it cannot fire, it fizzles. So this one fizzles. Then T1 is triggered, or is fired. Well, T1 just wants that as condition that there's something in place 1 and there is enough, there are 3 actually. So this can fire. Here goes 1 down, here goes 1 up. 4, like the 4th place is not affected by this transition. And then we have another one of T1 and so on and so forth. And you see that it actually works. So let's do another one. Every time I run this, it takes a random firing sequence. So in this case, also two times in a row T2, but then T1, everything is possible to fire. You see in the last place, a lot of things accumulate. Here we have, he wants to start with T1, T1, so the first place is deleted, like exhausted pretty quickly and fizzles quickly and so on and so forth. We can of course play this game like more. Let's say we fire 600 times. Well, what happens is, as I talked before, that this transition actually produces one token. It only consumes one, but it produces two. And whenever T2 fires, then one is added here and stays there forever. And so this is actually a Petri net where we have an accumulation on this side. And if I like start with a lot more tokens, let's say 10 in the first, what happens? Well, this outcome. Now you can actually do some, you know, probability theory and find out why actually this thing behaves as it does. What happens if we have zero in this place and let's fire again 6 times? Well, it's pretty sparse-ish. And if you actually start with 0, 0, well, then it can only fizzle, right? So this will always fizzle if this is empty, and if this is also empty from the start, then this can never be loaded, so there's only fizzling possible. On the other hand, if there's one here, well, then it can actually survive because then this token makes its turn and fills it up again and so on and so forth. So, okay, so this was our small excursion, well, almost an hour. I had some radio running. I'm not sure how that turned out, but I thought, you know, I actually have people just listening in and not watching, so I thought some change for a change. Okay, so hopefully I will actually get around this, and if I have more to say about the Petri nets and the state box approach, I might also talk some category theory in the future. So thanks for tuning in if you made it to the end, and goodbye.